Okay, so we left off without going into Balaam's ass. Now, let's not look at the scenario all that much, rather the purpose of the ass. And it is heavy labored. You know, an ass carries much weight, and it's once higher, you know. It does much work for I and I. And the reason that I even bring this up is because Isaiah in chapter 40, you know, the Lord cometh with his reward, and automatically it came to mind Issachar, you know, Issachar is compensation, and then that automatically linked to the ass, and even it went as far as defining a certain word as a donkey in the south, or burro. It even said burro. And so you know the ass is very at oftentimes related to Mexico and Issachar. And so just making that connection that the Lord coming with this reward, and what is the reward of Jesus Christos? And you know, inevitably it's salvation. So, you know, go back to the scenario of Balaam, and you know, the angel of the Lord even said so. If not for this ass, Balaam, I would have smote you. I would have smote you. I had the sword in hand and stuff. So, you know, sure, there's many interpretations, but it's almost certain that it's the ass is representing that salvation, that higher, and you know, going back to Issachar and being double burdened, or having to carry a double burden, I kind of can fit that role, because even though I can communicate with those that are of the geographical area of Mexico, I wouldn't be accepted to the fullness in that sense, because I wouldn't be able to relate in fullness to them, because in reality, my experience is I was raised up, I was brought up in Egypt, and so, you know, I'm stuck in the middle in a sense, because you know, they could tell right away. They don't have to ask. They know I'm not from there, but then again, I'm brought forth from Egypt, but then again, I don't fit that description. And so, not to say that, you know, that that's fulfilling, you know, that, but it's just we do take our script, our roles to play in scripture, if we choose to do so. So if we go to John chapter 12, it reminds us that took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him, and cried, Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. And Jesus, when he had found a young ass, sat thereon, as it is written. You know, and that's referencing to Isaiah chapter 40. And so these things understood not the disciples at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then remembered they that these things were written of him, and that they had done these things to him. So, and there's plenty of instances where every time the Lord he come right it in a colt's ass. And you know what's funny too? I think, and I can't prove this, but I was trying to look for the Hebraic letter, I guess, alphabet letter for heart, but I think kaf is like the, for some reason I think that's the ass, because he was a smart ass and he couldn't keep his mouth shut. And if you even remember that movie, that green monster, that Igor, and Shrek, there we go. You know that, funny enough, the actor, the interpreter, the voice behind the ass, is a Mexican comedian. He's actually quite, I think he's pretty intelligent, because, I don't know, he's really diverse in comedy. You know, not to say that I'm a fan, but, you know, you learn to distinguish, you know, skill. And so, anyways, it's funny because he won't shut up the whole, you know, he's a smartass. He won't shut up, you know. And in many cases, it's that off that, you know, that keep running that it gets you into trouble, sure, but it does good too. And so, you know, just throwing that out there, how I and I people, you know, we fit the scriptures in certain situations, you know, and as everyone takes their part in scripture, if they so wish to do so. But, you know, and just, you know, I just felt that was interesting, and not that it, no, it does make the world of a difference, because we're talking about salvation. And so, the Lord cometh riding on a colt, or so. Oh, that's why. Okay, I forgot. I kind of tried to divert the attention from that, because I kind of lost it. But colt, the reason I thought it was the cough, it was because of the colt. And since it's like this, since, you know, those horseshoes, and the colt, the mouth is like this, like coughing, you know. And I'll take this opportunity to, might as well, to just, to bring to life some of these moments in time. So I should have been doing this since the beginning, but you know, so be it. So okay, here's one good representation of okay, let's see if you could see that. Well, I'm pretty sure ones have already seen this. But every time there's always an ass, you know, involved, you know, and I think that's pretty interesting. And then let me go ahead and let me take it out of the. And then we have this picture right here, which is representing that same mom. Let's see if we can get it. This is in fact that actual scripture, you know, salvation, where everyone has their palms and Hosanna, salvation, you know, the King of Israel, and you know, I'm sure I got some more. Okay, let that be that. Okay, and this is a perfect, this is like the revelation. This is like the you know, that scene. It's even on the YouTubes when, and there's plenty of scenes where you know, Jack coming riding upon that horse. Even when you know, check out that movie, Star Wars, I mean, Judah, The Return of Judah, Star Wars, it's interesting, and, let's see if that works. Well, I mean, you get the picture, right? So, and, well, now that I and I is at it, this, in fact, was another inspired painting, you could say. This one, we can't say painting, but this is representative of the, let's see if you could get that, of the tabernacle. And I forgot exactly how this was incorporated to the actual Torah portion, Rastafari Sabbatical Study 45. But you know, For the longest time, I remember that Rasai Adonis had mentioned that he really liked that image where there's the queen, you could say, not sure what queen, but and there's a rainbow, and then there's the Lion of Judah. Well, I wasn't, for obvious reasons, I wasn't able to incorporate the Lion of Judah, but for sure we have Ethiopia stretching forth her hands to Jah Rastafari, and then upon the crown, the 12 stars, which is the tabernacle significantly, and upon the rock, building on the rock, those rock-hewn churches, and then the moon underneath, the moon and the sun underneath her feet, which are in fact, the altar of burnt sacrifice, and the brazen altar, and so on and so forth. So for the longest, I wanted to make a representation of this, and there it is. Just to add some color to the boredom. And go ahead and bring out the last inspired image. We have to go to Exodus chapter 20. Well, chapter 19, as a matter of fact. And I'm not going to read through it, but this chapter 19 and chapter 20, it goes right with the Torah portion of 45. But just to cut things short, I forgot what was the scripture that... It's going to be chapter 20. Oh, and here's another little detail that I wanted to mention. It seems that, the Lord tells Moses that make sure to sanctify everyone and put borders, lest they come too close and I shall consume them. And the Lord said to him, oh, hold on, I'm not going to do justice to this, but just throwing it out there so that ones can actually look into this. So, and the Lord said to Moses, go down, charge the people, lest they break through to the Lord to gaze, and many of them perish. And let the priests also, which come near to the Lord, sanctify themselves, lest the Lord break forth upon them. And Moses said to the Lord, he said, this is what Moses said, the people cannot come up to Mount Sinai, for thou chargest us, saying, set bounds about the mount, and sanctify it. And the Lord said to him, away, get thee down, and thou shalt come up, thou and Aaron with thee. But let the priest and the people break through to come up to the Lord, lest he break forth upon them. So Moses went down to the people and spoke to them. This is really confusing, but it's not confusing, but it's there's some deciphering that has to go on. Cause everything is not in a linear timeline. So just throwing that out there. I thought I had something, but turns out I didn't. At first, I was under the impression that Jah wanted I Am Thou to desire him, to want to break the... Oh, yeah, okay, this is, in a sense, it's a way of interpretation, not necessarily the most correct, but nevertheless significant. Just one second. Okay, so... I felt that Jah wanted us to really go after him, because we know that Jah is willing to turn away from wrongdoings if we really beseech him, if we really go after him. And so when Moses says that they can't come up, it's like, it's like the way he answers, like, get thee down from, you know, like go away, like, I don't even want to talk to you no more. It's like, so I was under the impression that that might have been what caused the wrath, or, you know, the wrath of the Lord to be kindled. And anyways, New Testament, the reason I think this is because New Testament, when Jesus Christos is, you know, he's walking down the lane, and this lady, she if only I could touch the corner of his garment, and she does so, and Jesus Christos turns around, and who, I like, I sense that what is it, virtue has gone forth from me. See, it's even the same text, the same words being used. But you know, she doesn't die. She gets saved because of her faith, you know, because she's she trusts that's enough to cure her, and her desire, her faith for that which was not seen, made her whole, you know, it cured her. So yeah, this is perfect, you know. It may not be the correct interpretation, but just to encourage all out there to really seek Jah Rastafari and take those blind, not blind because you're guided by the Spirit, but let's exercise eye and eye faith and towards Jah. Don't get this confused and try to do, you know, nonsense. But I think Jah really want eye and eye to go out there and try to reach him any way possible. And it might further progress for all Rastafari and inevitably for all the human community. So that being said, let's go to Isaiah chapter 40, just really, really briefly. That is where most of Iman inspiration came from. You know, comfort ye people, said the Lord, and speak comfortably. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare the way, make it straight. You know, the valleys shall be exalted. You know, the low made high. Every mountain and hill shall be made low. That's the cross, the raising of the tabernacle. Everything that was up is now down. Everything that was down has been raised up. And rough places have... Okay, and the crooked shall be made straight, and rough places plain. You know, this is just describing, the coming of this particular time, dispensation of time. But what was the main? Who hath measured, this is verse 12, who hath measured the waters in the hollow of his hand, and meted out heaven with the span, and comprehended the dust of the earth in one measure, in a measure, and weighed the mountains in scales, and the hills in a balance? Who hath directed the Spirit of the Lord, or being his counselor, has taught him? With whom took he counsel, and who instructed him, and taught him the path of judgment, and taught him knowledge, and showed to him the way of understanding? Behold, the nations are as a drop of a bucket, and are counted as the small dust of the balance. Behold, he taketh up the isles as a very little thing. You know, so once again, this poetry, you know, being taken up with the Spirit. So this is important right here. To whom will ye liken God? Or what likeness will ye compare to him? The workman, I melted a graven image, blasphemy, and the goldsmith spread it over with gold, and cast it silver chains. Away with that. I seek gold, tried with the fire, melted gold, you know, proved worthy. And so taking different forms, different properties, you know, of solid, liquid, gas, air, you know. And so continuing, he that is so impoverished that he hath no oblation, choose it a tree that will not rot. Even Yehoshua, you know, as the tree of life. Him cunning, and he seeketh to him a cunning workman to prepare a graven image that shall not be moved. You know, so that's interesting right there. But have ye not known? Have ye not heard? Hath it not been told to you from the beginning? Have ye not understood from the foundation of the earth? It is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth. That's where that inspired picture of Jesus Christos it comes into effect. And it is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth, and the inhabitants thereof are as grasshoppers, that stretcheth out the heavens as a curtain. That is interesting too. And spreadeth them out as a tent to dwell in. That bringeth the princes to nothing. He maketh the judges of the earth as vanity. They shall not be planted at a blow upon. So, okay, so, you know, I'm going to stop right there, but, once again, this depiction of Jesus Christos, who stands in the circle of the earth, and, you know, everything is like grasshoppers to him, you know, like exalted, you know, in his glory, glorified. So, and it's to say, it's to say that those that are humble shall be exalted, you know. And that reminds me that I didn't even cover the part of Exodus that I wanted to cover in reality. So, just, you know, bear with, I apologize. Okay, so I wanted to mention that. In all places where I record my name, blessed be the God of Shem, the God of the name, I will come to thee, and I will bless thee. And if thou will make me an altar of stone, thou shalt not build it of hewn stone. For if thou lift up thy tool upon it, thou hast polluted it. Neither shalt thou go up by steps to mine altar, that thy nakedness be not discovered thereon. You see, do not exalt yourselves. You know, like, Lalabella is a perfect example of this. Rock hewn, dig it. You know, the safety is, you dig safety. You don't exalt yourself. Everything that comes up must be brought down, but that which is down will be brought up, you know? Forgive I will be brought up. And so, this is trying to express humility. Be humble. And that's where this last inspired, a picture, drawing comes into play. Okay, this is a representation of that, of humility. You know, the head cornerstone, the first, the foundation. You know, since the beginning of the worlds, even. This is actually supposed to represent one of those Mayan pyramids in Mexico. But most importantly, it's a representation of you know, it clearly in scripture it says not to build an altar, you know, not to build it up. And I know this is an altar built up, right? But it's only to give this, you know, okay, it's only to show that this, that's his flask, you know, and the coronation wardrobe, the crown, and but he's below that, you know. The emperor is depicted as he's not up on the pyramid, you know, he is the pyramid. So build on that, you know. So just I guess I thought it was a better representation, but now that I think about it, it's not that great. But still, I actually saw this, alright? So, you know, open your eyes and pay attention, and there's stuff out there. And, you know, I saw this I often take pictures of light, and you know, you can see them anywhere, but that was where I got that from. A picture I took in my mom's backyard. I just flipped the phone upside down, and surely enough, it was there. But you know, light is the life, so seek it in the light. Well, I guess to finalize, conclude, and not to go into the actual readings, you know, I've bored some enough for this sabbatical study, but I don't want to go. I don't want to even, you know, go into the Sadducees and Pharisees playing family double dare. And that's, you know, I say that because every time that Jesus Christo responds, they huddle. They huddle and they reason. How ridiculous is that? You know, I will say that I love the New Testament when I first started reading it. I just thought it was so funny and so exciting. Every time, like, the Sadducees and Pharisees and scribes were to appear, I really got interested, because I was like, I didn't know Jesus Christ, but I did, you know, deep within myself. And it was like, I could see him, and I know what he's thinking. Like, I know, it's like, you know, it's that feeling when you're like, oh, man. You know, he often tells his disciples, like, you know what, why don't you guys go get some bread, here comes these Gentile men, you know, like, that kind of feeling, like, ah, oh, you know, like, now I gotta waste, like, 20 minutes of my time, you know, dealing with these, you know, like, it's a joke, you know, like, it's kind of annoying, but it's kind of fun sometimes, but not really. But so you know, I really enjoy that aspect of the New Testament, cause it got nothing on him, you know. It's like, imagine, you know, Jesus responds well, and they huddle up, you know, in public, they like to decide what they're gonna answer, you know. Like, I just think that's pretty, you know, if you see that going on nowadays, you'd be kind of like, it would make more sense what I'm trying to say. But now that I have mentioned that, it is important to mention that this is a logic, I guess a little pointer, a tip, take a tip from, take some advice from the counselor of counselors, Jesus Christos, even I and I Father, Kedamawi Haile Shalasi, them too, you know, blessed be them, they always, and this is taught in critical thinking logic, to make sure that you stick with the question, you address the question, and then you point out and address that you have addressed the question. His Majesty and Jesus Christos always repeat the question before giving the answer. So if in this case they ask them, what is the greatest commandment? And Jesus Christos, even His Majesty, will continue to say, the first and greatest commandment is, and then they're going to give the answer, and then they're going to repeat the question to reinforce the fact that, okay, addressing the question to stay with the topic, answer the question, you know, in topic, and then address that you have now answered the question regarding the topic. So the first and most important commandment, the greatest commandment, is, you know, Shema Israel Yahweh Elohim Yahweh Ahad Israel Hoy Sima Amlakachin Igziab Her Anede Igziab Her Newe. Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one. You know, escucha Israel, el Señor Nuestro Señor Dios es uno. Ahad, ahadu, anede, uno, one. And so, that's really, really, really useful, because when I'm debating, when, you know, these kind of these pointers, they really do help, because it even reminds yourself, like, okay, this is the question, stick to it, answer it, you know. Okay, now it's kind of like a victory chant, like, okay, the question has been addressed. Because oftentimes you can ask people, so how old are you? And they're gonna respond, dude, last time on Friday, it was a killer party. And then the person that asked the question of how old he was, him being in just as ignorant as the one that answered foolishly, will be like, oh yeah, that was a great party. And they'll never figure out that they don't even know what they said. And so, you know, logic, the word, the logos is really important. So, you know, just a pointer and just a helpful tip, I would say. And to finalize the sharing of information, and I have to just point out that love thy brother as yourself, you know, which is the greatest commandment, which is, well, it's the second greatest. First, love the Lord God that is one with all thy heart. And, you know, there is nothing greater. Him desired nothing else than I and I to love his son with more love than that we have for him, because he glorifieth in the son. You know, he loveth the son. You know, you can't tell a father that you know, everyone knows that even fleshy fathers, being as imperfect as they are, the love for their child, in some cases, I would say, but unfortunately, nevertheless, you know, the love of father or a mother to a son, it's like, it's the greatest. So so it's the same situation, you know. Jai don't want to, you know, his majesty don't want to even hear it, you know. It's like, love my son. And that's more than loving I, because I want my son to have everything, you know. All things have been given to the son, you know, by the father. And so, to conclude, very, 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 very important topic, little detail, is that when this man, the scribe, says, thou hast answered well, he tells Jesus, the greatest commandment is to love the Lord our God that is one and none other but him, with all our hearts, all our strength, all our desire, all our might, all our soul, our mind, you know. And says, and the second is to love thy neighbor as thyself. But then the key is when the narrative says, and when Jesus saw that he had answered discreetly, this is what Jesus responds, thou art not far from the kingdom of heaven. Let me go to it, because I'm not sure if it says kingdom of heaven or... Okay, yeah, it's on verse 34, chapter 12 of the Marcos Wengel, and it says, and when Jesus saw that he answered discreetly, he said to him, thou art not far from the kingdom of God. Correction, not heaven, kingdom of God. And no man after that dared ask him any question. Key word is discreet. He saw that he answered discreet, like he kind of whispered, like, yeah, like, you know. And I'm sure, without a doubt, you know, unless proven otherwise, that if the scribe would have yelled it out to the top of his, with, you know, with a loud voice, a loud chant, to the top of his lungs, Jesus would have said, he would have been in the kingdom. But since he said it, like, discreetly, Jesus had to answer, thou art not far. So, you know, that little detail is very important, because I and I is to proclaim Jah Rastafari with enthusiasm and excitement, and, you know, tell Jerusalem that Judah, you know, that who ruleth Judah, and you know, that should have been covered in the book of Isaiah chapter 40, but you know, it's nevertheless, you know, make a joyful noise for the Lord, you know. And so it's what it comes down to, you know, exalt the name, but with gladly and with strength, with all thy strength. That's what that signifies, to the top of your lungs, you know, with all that thy might, you know, that it be heard from heaven to earth, you know. So yeah, let's end it there. Thank you very much for putting up with I and I. So give thanks, you know, God guide and protect all and I.